this tutorial, you'll learn about DataRobot's AI experimentation capabilities. Specifically, you'll understand what data types can be used, what problem types can be solved, what modeling techniques can be applied, and what external tools and technologies can be incorporated into your solution design. This is important because breadth of experimentation, speed of experimentation, choice, and flexibility are key strengths of the DataRobot AI platform. A platform capable of running and organizing many simultaneous experiments allows you to find the optimal solution to a new problem very quickly. Importantly, the platform approach makes each of those experiments immediately deployable, using the same deployment process regardless of the data type, problem type, and modeling approaches involved. It's the combination of rapid experimentation and standardized deployment and governance processes that allowed these four organizations to move so quickly. This graphic depicts the diversity of problems, modeling techniques, and data types that DataRobot can help you with. You really can mix and match anything from these three areas and immediately access the most advanced techniques. Let me explain why this matters. Just because a person carries the title Senior Data Scientist does not mean that they have deep experience with text in multiple languages, with geospatial coordinates, with neural networks, with streaming timestamped data, with anomaly detection, with computer vision, and most recently with LLMs and generative use cases. These are all specialties within the field, and any one individual may only be an expert in one or two of them. DataRobot brings world-class capabilities in all these areas to your senior and your junior data scientists. That's a good segue into a brief comment about interoperability and openness. The DataRobot AI platform is very intentionally open and extensible and integrates with all these different products. The tech ecosystem is changing so quickly, especially on the generative AI side of things, that you need the flexibility to bring in new tools as they emerge. DataRobot works with all cloud environments and data stores and allows you to integrate generative tools, including vector databases and LLM APIs. Let's take a look at a few examples in the graphical user interface. Everything you see here can also be initiated and manipulated in code if you prefer. As a quick orientation, I've clicked on Manage Projects to access all my projects, and then I've filtered them based on the examples I want to show. This is what we call the DataRobot Classic view. If your view is different, you can toggle between Classic and Workbench from the main navigation menu. There are a few key things to notice in this summary view. First, notice the column labeled Model Type. Then notice the column named Target. If this is filled in, it's a supervised machine learning problem. If it's blank, it's unsupervised. Then notice the column labeled Time Aware. Three of the examples will make use of DataRobot's market-leading time series capabilities. Lastly, notice number of models. This is the number of complete and deployable machine learning pipelines that have been tested for each problem. As I provide an overview of each problem type, I'll put up on screen the list of all the modeling techniques that have been tested, so you can see the breadth of coverage for yourself. Example number one is a binary classification problem. To decide whether a review left on Amazon is helpful, using only the review text as input. Example number two is a multi-label classification problem that uses images. Each article of clothing belongs in multiple categories, such as red and dress. Example number three is a regression problem to predict housing prices. It uses listing information, pictures, geospatial coordinates, and photographs. It's tagged as multimodal because it combines all five data types in one example. Example number four is an anomaly detection problem that looks for unusual computer network traffic that might signal a cyber attack. There's no target because it's an unsupervised problem. Example five is a time-aware problem, as are six and seven. Number five is a forecasting problem that uses daily historical sales, text descriptions of promotions, and some external consumer price index data to forecast sales by SKU. Example number 6 is a time series clustering problem. The goal here is to find which grocery items have similar sales patterns. And example number 7 is a time series anomaly detection problem that examines streaming data coming from multiple motors in a fabrication facility to detect if the system is behaving normally or might be about to experience a failure. Our final example is in the workbench section, so let's head over there now. This is a use case for a generative chatbot that uses confidential internal documents as sources for the generation. The experiments to be run here are in the design of the prompt, the choice of the vector database, and the choice of the LLM. That concludes our capabilities overview across data types, problem types, and modeling techniques. I hope you have a better understanding of how breadth and speed of experimentation, choice, and flexibility allow you as the DataRobot user to derive more value from AI.